yet. Now okay. It is.
Oh yeah, okay. And his team worked Apple, he worked at Qualcomm on computer vision, machine learning, and the mobile phones. Before that, he also worked on Sony, Micron, Broadcom, and many other different companies. And Dr. Chen received a PhD in imaging science at RIT, an MS and BS from optical engineering in Beijing Institute of Technology. And he has already more than 40 international patents and published more than 20 papers already. And that is for Dr. Chen and for Dr. Jiang. And right now, she is the principal engineer and manager in Qualcomm camera system team, and in charge of cameras IPS algorithm development. Her team worked on camera ISP algorithm design for premium tier chips, and turning new sensor support and essential feature development. And Dr. Jiang also received a PhD in image science at RIT and MS and BS from Beijing Institute of Technology. And actually about 1 year ago, I met with Dr. Chen and Dr. Jiang in CVPR in 2019. And later after that, I talked with our director, and I told our director, and who is also here, Dr. Messenger, about I met with a couple who are actually RIT imaging science alumni. And at that time, Dr. Messenger told me, why not we invite them in a special session that introduced to our student with our excellent alumni, and so tell our students their experience of their study here and later their career development, their research, and inspire our students. So after that, we try to organize, but because of different time in California and New York State and COVID-19 and all of those things postponed the talk. But right now we're fortunate to have Dr. Chen and Dr. Jiang to give us the talk. Okay, now the talk is about 1 hour, but it's flexible because this is the first time we organize two speakers in the same seminar talk. So I think probably is a little bit flexible. So if is designed to be 1 hour, but for questions or some other things, and if several minutes. We have some minutes flexible. So I don't know how do you want to give the talk? Is one by one or somehow mixture or session by session? That really depends on you the better.
Maybe I can go first because okay. I think my topic is different from Shuxue's topic. So mm-hmm. I can go ahead first.
Yeah. Sure.
Okay, let me just... Yeah. Okay. Can you see us now?
Yes. You start sharing, but right now you can. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, first, thanks a lot for your invitation so that I can have the chance to give you guys some introduction of color and image processing inside of the mobile camera. So I have first introduced a little bit of about myself. I got my PhD degree in imaging science from Monsieur Color Science Lab in 2003. And after that, I joined Qualcomm, so it has been 17 years. I'm in the camera system team. So in the beginning, I mainly worked on the color processing and color optimization, so which is related with my PhD study. And later, camera tends to be more and more complicated. So we moved ahead to the special and temporary processing and height and range processing and other parts. So to cover the whole ISP processing. So and today, mobile camera has been much more complicated comparing to 15 years ago. And the algorithm inside it are also much more complicated from when I joined the camera team. So today I just give you guys a very simple introduction of the mobile camera processing in case you're curious what are in. So first I will have a very brief introduction of our camera ISP processing. You see that the lights go inside and from the module, and the module composed of the lens and the sensor. Those are the main parts, and then go through the ISP. The ISP generates a hardware design. And so after that, the signals go to send to the display or to the video to do the compression. So this diagram shows the main components inside of the camera system design. In fact, they're also the architecture of the camera system team. Definitely the system team is more than this, but those are the design parts. So you can see that it has a module, camera module. So some people need to have dedicated study of the module parts, how to handle the different modules, and also the ISP part. So that is the main, the hardware processing part. And then our 3A parts, is 3A means AWB, auto white balance, auto exposure, and auto focus. So those are the most important controls inside the camera. So those are separate people to do this, dedicated to do this study. And also the essential feature team. Essential feature to many of the high level features, they can be inside of the ISP or outside of the ISP as a software processing. So the essential feature team is take care of the more advanced features. And tuning is quite important to be in the camera system team. So because each of the components need to have good tuning to have the best quality. And later we have the quality evaluation team. So this is dedicated team to do the quality evaluation for each of the components or the overall end-to-end system quality. And they also do the competitive analysis of our solution comparing to the other competitors. And then we deliver our solution to our customers. And we have many Chinese customers like Xiaomi, Oppo, Vivo, OnePlus. And we have Korean customers from Samsung, LG, and also some US. So those are part of our main OEMs. So they will do the evaluations on their device. So, and also another round of quality tests. And we also need to provide a lot of supports, customer supports to them to make sure the final quality is good. So we are generally a product team, but we are working on the algorithm design inside it. So in fact, it's quite challenging because it's not like R&D. So you just show the best part of your solution, but for ours, so we need to deal with all the corner cases. And also, you need to have the design. That is a very kind of cost effective to be able to be inside of the pipeline and with high efficiency, low power, and the low area cost, and but to be able to achieve the high quality. So this diagram show a general, very simple introduction of the camera ISP processing. So you can see that this is the raw image, and raw image right now is not necessarily the bear. So we have more patterns in addition to the bear. And first we need to go through the sensor pre-processing. So generally we kind of make them to be the bear pattern for those non-bear pattern and also some of the pre-processing here. And later we do the first in the bear domain to do the lens roll and white balance. Those are the basic processing. And then we do the bear domain denoising, diffractive pixel correction, and then demosaic, color correction, gamma correction, high dynamic range processing, noise reduction, and sharpening. So those are just some examples of the main processings inside of the camera and the auto, but the auto is definitely not necessary to be this auto. Different ISP have different auto, and the goal is similar. So after those processing, and we got the beautiful images that you see use your phone camera to be able to get. So those are the general introduction of the ISP. So if you have any question, just let me know, just stop anytime you want. Okay. So feel free to ask questions in between, I think. Okay. Okay, so first I will introduce about the sensor processing. So you can see that this is the Samsung GS20 mobile camera. Right now, more and more cameras are used in the mobile phone. Generally, it is normally we have three phones: ultra wide, wide, and tele. And also, this one has another depth camera to be able to capture the depth information. During those several years, the sensor development is very, very fast. So you can see a lot of differentiations from the sensor side. For a long, long time, we only take care of bare pattern. So that is the main, the camera sensor pattern that we need to deal with. And a couple of years ago, and then we have the stack HDR come out. This is mainly for the hidden range processing. And also one, this one is called a core CFA pattern. And you can see that we have 2x2 inside of this, each of the original bare pattern. And this pattern tends to be very popular because it can achieve binning and hidden range and also full resolution easily inside of this, just the switching the mode inside of the sensor. And now we have more like patterns come out, like more Nona, that is 3x3 core CFA pattern, and 4x4 CFA, and also OEMs, they have their own design about the, some patterns that they like. And this one is like, it can be RGBW or RGBIR, so for different purposes. So it's like, in addition to the three color channels, so we have four color channels. And later, and we are, it's not later, it's also currently, we have, they are different, we have QPD, this is PD, it's mainly for autofocus, and TOF, that is for the depth information. And while we use this RYY, instead of green, they use the yellow. And this one is like, instead of the patterns, the sensor output, the three channels for full resolution directly. So all those variations need to be handled inside our ISP. So different sensor patterns go through our ISP sensor processing output bit. So generally in our ISP, we need to handle different types of sensors. So inside that, we need to support different modes, like the binning modes, remote is to get the full resolution mode or HDR mode. So the sensor itself can have different exposure for different pixels, so to be able to get the HDR combination. So those are the general, the big picture of our the sensor processing side inside of the ISP. And this one, I just show one example of why customers like to use this like 4x4 CFA pattern. It's like the use cases example. So you can see that with this sensor, it's pretty easy to do the binning. So for low light condition or for low resolution output like preview video, it just do the 4x4 binning directly to output the bit. And so the, and also the bandwidth, the things is small. And it also can do the 2x2 binning and 2x2 remosaic. So it has in the middle of the resolution and also the power consumption, this one can be used as a normal mode. And it can also to do the 4x4 remosaic to be able to get every pixel information. And when you do in the zooming mode, or like when you do the zooming, or you do like full resolution, a big picture for snapshot, you use this mode. So here, I just want to show one example of this 4x4 CFA for zooming. You can see that, okay, this is one X, that is like we do the 4x4 binning. So that it's kind of like for like a preview video or for low light condition, we just use this mode to get the picture. And when we do the 2x zoom, so that is the sensor doing the 2x2 binning and followed by 2x2 remote, you can see that we have inside of the sensor that has more details. If you go further to do the zooming, and you can see much more details comparing to the original binning plus upscaling. So this is that's also one of the reasons that kind of this type of sensor tends to be more popular, because they can do like easily to do the mode switch, just to use the same sensor instead of using different camera. Okay, later I will talk a little bit about the color processing, because this is like, you know, we are from color science, you know, mostly a color science lab. So this one, for the color processing, auto white balance is very, very important in the inside of the camera processing. And we have different light conditions from yellowish light to the bluish light. under the different different light source, and so that kind of so how do we figure out what is the light source? So we know that the final image is generated from the illumination and the object reflectance and the sensor sensitivity. All the three parts combine together to get the final image. So when we have the output, how can we get the color, figure out the illumination to be accurate? There are different type of methods and like a gray word and the color consistent PCA based, the different type of the white balance algorithms. And even with them, even with very good white balance algorithm, there are still many of the challenging parts. So for example, this one, like the light condition differentiations, light condition, so it's like the mixed light. So partially of the image is taken under the constant light and it's partially under the outdoor. So how to do the white balance accurately for the whole image. And also sometimes it's under the low light, the color is not vivid at all because the response is pretty low. How to do the correct white balance with the very low color signals. And sometimes it can be like the scene itself can be like a dominant with only one color, just like a blue sky, or you take a picture of your door, the yellowish door or something, or only your hand. So how can it figure out the correct the color instead of treat them as gray, but be able to figure out the correct color with the AWB algorithm. And sometimes it's like the special tone. So if you do the correct white balance, it may not look good. Finally, the feeling is not good to represent the original condition. So there are still many challenges inside of the AWB. So in addition to the traditional method, right now AI assisted AWB decision is also tends to be popular. Okay, and here I want to talk a little bit about the color processing. So color processing, we can see that this is generally what we do for the color camera color reproduction. And map best chart is the widely used. This is a very important for our color reproduction. So inside the light booth, we take pictures of different light conditions. And generally, we do the global color optimization. So with the global color optimization, we can mark, this is the target, what the color should be located at. And with our color correction, what is the color we can achieve? So overall, based on whatever delta E or some other methods, we do the optimizer to make the overall color to be accurate so that the original sensor output to after this color correction to get the accurate accurate color reproduction of each of the color patch. So this is our general global color optimization. But for the customers, it is pretty common that they want to have the special color treatment within the image, although they also want this kind of general color to be accurate, they wanted to tune the skin tone to be a little bit more like a pale so that you look better, or the blue sky to be like more bluish, and the green trees. So they want to adjust their colors according to the preference. It's not necessary to be accurate. So those are like the pretty common for color reproduction requirement. So with those special requirement, the global color optimization will not be enough. So they wanted the different special color treatment. So it's not like the general color metrics can be able to achieve. So with that, we need to have a more localized color optimization. This is an example of the 3D color lookup table and to be used to do the better color reproduction. But we also need to consider the cost inside our hardware implementation. Okay, so this is some general introduction of our color processing. Any question?
Actually, if you have any question, you can raise right now, or you can later at the end, you can raise the question together, and or you can leave the messages in the chat box, and I will read the questions if you are shy to talk in public.
Okay, yeah, thanks, Guru. Okay, so here is a little bit about the HDR processing, and HDR is right now is more and more popular. comparing to a few years ago. And so you can see that HDR in your like mobile phone, and when you take a picture, it will have the HDR mode. And now even preview video, we also have the HDR turn on. So this one shows the example without HDR and with HDR. So generally, one of the like the common method to achieve the high dynamic range is to have the different exposure to be combined together. So this is like the normal exposure, and also we take pictures of that like the longer exposure and the shorter exposure, so that combine the different images together to be able to get the high dynamic range images. But there are a lot of challenges when we combine them together. It's not like that straightforward, you just add them together. Okay, so there can be global motions, local motions in between, and how to handle those motions, and also to be able to have the high good like dynamic range compression, and to make the image, final image, looks natural with good contrast, the local contrast, and good feeling, tone, color feeling. So those are all the studies inside the HDR processing. And this one shows the examples of the HDR processing for the automotive. Automotive is more challenging comparing to our normal use cases, because the automotive need to handle very special case because it's for the safety reason. And so this is like a much higher requirement. So this one's like the cars driving through the tunnel. If you don't have the good HDR processing, you don't see anything outside, or when you go inside, you don't see anything inside. So so this one generally for the automotive, we have very high like the bitwidth to keep the dynamic range. So it's 24-bit dynamic range. So the original signal has all the information inside, but the output, the final output is only like, I said it's here 14-bit, but sometimes like 10-bit or 8-bit. So all the way you need to compress the data from 24-bit to 8-bit. So it's a very big like the dynamic compression. So this is a pretty challenging for the high dynamic range processing algorithm to be able to recover all the details in the within the limited bitwidth, but with a very good recovery. Okay, so this one is just to show an example of for the dark things. I think it's right now it's for darker things, the images can be noisy and without the lose the details of the highlight regions. And so HDR processing for dark things, so it can reduce the noise. So this is kind of with the combination of multiple exposures without any denoising here. It's just through the combination of different exposures, you can see that noise get reduced, and we can also keep the highlight regions much better comparing to before. So those are some of the basic introduction of the HDR processing. Okay, later I will talk about the noise and the texture. And noise and texture, in fact, is like very, very important in ISP. So a big area inside the ISP is used to deal with the noise and texture. So we know that noise and texture are conflict with each other. If you want to do the better denoising, you cannot keep the texture better. If you want to keep the more texture, more noise will be kept. So those are definitely people are dealing with this with different algorithms. We have like a wavelet-based BM3D, and also nearest neighbor and different methods, but we also need to implement inside the hardware. So you can see that the mobile phone camera, the processing for the denoising part has been improved quite a lot during those several years. This one just to show an example of the iPhone, different iPhones from 2013 with iPhone 5S to current like iPhone 11 Pro. So you can see this is exactly the same light condition, 5 lux and same picture. And when we take them with, so like 7 years ago, you're in low light condition, you will get the image like this. And right now you will get like the appearance like this. So it has been used just from the mobile phone. And in fact, the quality of your image has been changed a lot during those several years. Okay. So talking about the noise and texture, I have to talk about this kind of this test chart, because this is what we use heavily about to do the quality evaluation of this using this test chart. You can see that the center, the cement star, and also the corner ones used to measure the resolution. What is the resolution you can achieve? and also those kind of this dead leaf charts. This is a low contrast dead leaf charts, and this is a high contrast dead leaf charts to see how much texture it can recover. And also the other regions, so you can see that your noise reproduction, noise level on the different the intensity level. And this one with the stone and the grass to see how the texture recovery, the natural, how natural they are. And here is a human face. So when you have the good, you have to make sure your face regions have very good noise reduction and also the details recovery inside. So the human face is a very important, need to be have the special treatment in the ISP to have the good reproduction. Okay, so even with all those kind of advanced technologies to recover the texture and reduce the noise, we still see the texture gap between the smartphone and the DSLR. So for example, right now when we capture a picture like this with the DSLR and the smartphone, you don't see much of the difference. The appearance sometimes from smartphone can be even better than DSLR. But if you zoom in quite a lot and look at the details here, you can still see that, okay, the smartphone can achieve, still have some gap of the texture of the real signals comparing to the DSLR. So this is also some part that is smartphones keep improving to that direction. So this one talk about the essential features, some of the essential features. So right now and after those several years of development, phone camera has been largely replaced the DSC. And right now the goal is to be able to achieve the appearance or the quality of similar to DSLR. Definitely it's quite challenging because you can see how big the mobile phone modules and also this big high quality lens and also the big size sensor inside of the DSLR. So there are several areas that the essential features are focusing on currently in the mobile camera side. The first is the dynamic range recovery. As I mentioned, this is a very important part right now. It's very popular. In mobile camera, and we found this part for a mobile phone can achieve even better quality comparing to DSLR. And also for the night things, this one definitely DSLR has the advantage. So, and also with the multiple frame combination and also AI assisted denoising, those new technologies right now, mobile phone for the night scene recovery is much better comparing to before. And for the zooming, and zooming is also very, very important for the mobile phone. That is also one of the reasons the mobile phone need to have several cameras to recover the ultra wide and also for the tele to achieve high quality, like the real zooming, quality. So it's also why we have the sensor design to be able to achieve different like in-sensor remosaic to be able to achieve high quality zoom. And the bokeh, and this is something special for DSLR, but with good high quality segmentation algorithm and also depth assisted processing. Currently, the mobile phone can also achieve a good quality bokeh effect. And this one is a stabilization. So EIS is a quite important feature also inside of the mobile phone so that we can achieve a good quality of image video stabilization through the technologies inside the phone. Okay, so those are some of the introduction of the essential features that we are working on. Okay, the last, I will talk a little bit about the camera quality evaluation. And talking about quality evaluation, we have to mention about the DXO mark. So DXO mark plays an important role on the the mobile phone image quality evaluations. Yeah, they have been very established and also have very high reputation about the. So when you judge the camera, mobile phone camera quality, generally the people always use the DxOMark score so how high your score is to represent your camera quality. So you can see that the DxOMark evaluate the quality on the photo and also video for the camera side. And for the photo part, it has like exposure, dynamic range, those are combined together. So to see the like the tone recovery. And also for, it has a color. The color, including both of the color reproduction and also white balance, those are the things inside of the color evaluation and the autofocus. They also evaluate the consistency and your autofocus response speed. And the texture as a noise and texture, those is like a very important part in the quality evaluation. And artifacts, they have definitions of what kind of the artifacts. Because like when you do the demosaic of the things, you can have color aliasing and also the reading color artifact and the ghosting. When you do the HDR combination, it's pretty easy to generate the ghost. So they have according to the different cases to have the artifact and the flash. And also those parts, several things are something new. And right now you can see that because people care more and more about the quality of the night scene and the zoom cases and the bokeh effect and also the wide camera, the wider wide camera quality. So those are new added items to fit the new requirements on the camera. You can see the camera, mobile camera trends. And for the video side, it evaluates the exposure, color information, autofocus, texture, noise, the artifact, and the stabilization. So those are a little bit traditional, still the traditional measurement. And the final score is the combination of photo and video. So this is like two-third of the overall score. This is like one-third of the overall score. So combined together, they get the final score. So this couple of years, the competition of the DxOMark IQ is very high. So people, just to get the high DxOMark score, that means that your camera quality is it's very good to get recognized. So this is like in Paris, in fact. So they have just like they do quality evaluations on many, many phones. You can see that those red bars are with our Qualcomm Snapdragon inside it. So those are using our camera solution inside the mobile phones. So you can see that iPhone is iPhone 11 Pro is right here, 117. In fact, it has been pretty high score. And Samsung, this is a Galaxy Note 10 Plus. So, but Samsung doesn't involve much in the competition recently. So because their score is not that high. So this is in fact Exynos. It's not our Qualcomm chip. So you can see that Qualcomm chip, the camera solution in premium tier plays an important role in the customers and also help them to achieve a very high score of for their camera solution. So this is the most recent one, and 130 is the highest score currently in DxOMark score. So this is from our Snapdragon and Xiaomi phone camera. Okay, I think that is all what I have today. If you have any question, just let me know.
I would say if everybody has some quick question right now, you can ask, or we can leave at the end and for all the questions. Is there any quick question right now you anybody want to ask? And then I think we can move forward with Dr. Chen's talk. And later, actually, I have some questions, but I want to leave at the end to ask together.
Okay, sure. Yeah. Okay.
Dr. Chen, you can go ahead.
Okay, thank you. I thank Dr. Lu and also Dr. Messengers inviting Xiaoyun and me to introduce our research and development work today. And it's my honor to be here. And so my part of the presentation is on the computer vision for mobile imaging processor. So back to like 20 years ago, when I learned the digital image processing at Dr. Roddy's class, connected component analysis actually is an important algorithm, and we program it with IDL. And now even after these years, so when we interview some candidates, or even I got interviewed at some other companies before, we still connected component analysis is still one of the very interesting image analysis algorithm to be used. So this actually, I have put some very old pictures. They were taken with a very, at that time was a very a new digital camera. It's like a Fujifilm camera given by my advisor, the Xerox chair, Dr. Ota. So the images below are when we attended the International Color Association meeting at in Rochester. So I took some pictures. Xiaoyun and I were on the right, and Xiaoyun also posed with Dr. Roy Benz and his wife. And about that was when I was at RIT in the imaging science in the room. Yeah. So after I finished my PhD at Center for Imaging Science on the color science track, I joined the Sony because actually my PhD study project was sponsored by Sony. So so this is a continuation of the work on the color optimization and the optimization of camera spectral sensitivity. So my time with Sony, basically at Sony, work on so-called four color sensor and the camera. So as Xiaoyun just mentioned, the different kind of bayer patterns. So that's true. Even like 15 or 17 years ago, we have this RGB plus E is emerald. So this is basically a four color sensor on the left, and on the bottom you can see there is a subtle difference for the color processing generated by three color filter camera and the four color filter camera. The color for generated by four color filter camera is richer. So on the right side, on the top, this is the CCD sensor with the RGBE filter. And this is the Sony camera produced in 2004 with this color filter, yeah, behind. So recently, 2 years ago, I joined from Qualcomm to OPPO US Research Center. Probably OPPO maybe is not known to you, but OPPO actually in the recent years is in terms of market share, it's number two in China and number four or number six in the world. And if so OPPO actually 15 years ago, they already have this product called a Blu-ray player. It's a very high-end reference style Blu-ray player. OPPO has a subsidiary company called OnePlus. So OnePlus smartphone is available like on T-Mobile. So So OPPO currently mainly works on the smartphone and also wearable products like earphones and watches and so on. Yeah. By the way, yeah, OPPO is one of our major customer of Qualcomm. So I mainly talk about two tasks that I involved. One is when I was at Qualcomm, I was in the team working on hybrid computer vision and deep learning architecture for imaging applications. So that is part of the computer vision for mobile imaging processor. So this this part of slide actually is public. I was in the behind, but then the slides were presented by the product manager Robert Lee. So I was able to get the slides. So show you. So in recent, my career itself, after I finished my PhD from RIT, the first 10 years I mainly work on ISP and related multimedia research and development. Later, in the last 8 years, mainly work on computer vision and deep learning. So these are also can be regarded as the complementary features for the ISP itself. So at first, the ISPs, so I worked on like a skin color detection and also face detection. So those are the some of the fundamental detection features for ISP. But later in the recent, like 8 to 10 years, with the advanced for computer vision and machine learning, so more advanced features are added into the mobile imaging processor. So these computer vision features, first, let's say from OpenCV, I think a lot of people use OpenCV to prototype computer vision algorithms, but those computer vision prototyping work mainly run on desktop PC or laptop. Then like for at Qualcomm, we needed to try to run most things on the mobile chip. So when I was at Qualcomm, we have a library called FastCV. So that's an accelerated version of OpenCV, runs on the CPU, DSP, and the GPU to accelerate those algorithms and also reduce the power consumption on the mobile chips. However, that's not enough. So in the last 5 years, the team I was working with, so we produced some, basically extracted some key computer vision functions and try to run those functions on dedicated hardware. So that dedicated hardware is called Qualcomm Spectra CV Hardware Processor, CVP. Yeah, so the CVP, it does not cover a lot of functions, but some of the majority of the computer vision tasks. For example, the first category is called pre-processing and detection. So basically, this have some image processing functions, pyramid scaler, downscaler. Then this feature descriptor, it's a sort of like histogram of Gaussian and or SAF aggregated channel feature and so on. Then object tracking and motion processing. Object tracking is also very important. When we detect a certain object, for example, a face, a person, and so on. So the tracking usually it's can be done through like optical flow, feature point extraction, binary feature descriptor, and NCC. So those are the second category. And the third category is called like a classification, for example, SVM. And then this one, the geometric correction engine. So this one, basically, we know that for some of the computer vision related work, we use low fisheye cameras. So the fisheye cameras, it has involved a lot of distortion. So this is how to correct those distortions. We need like a dedicated hardware to do that, so that the computation can be done in real time and also lower the power consumption. Then the depth processing. The depth processing, for example, from dual cameras, this dual camera may not be identical. This is also very good for important for like a still for like a bokeh effect. Then the overall inside the mobile imaging processor, the so-called embedded processor to do the scheduling and the concurrency handling of how to use this multiple instance of these functions. So there are some examples to use this so-called CVP. So in this diagram, it's for the real-time video bokeh or segmentation. So we need to generate the depth from this picture and then crop out the region of interest. Here is mainly a person. So in this the algorithm, the blue blocks are processed by the CVP. And then CVP, computer vision processor acceleration for the 3D scene understanding. So 3D scene understanding is getting more and more important. We just want to know what are the semantic information of the in the picture, what are the objects and their profiles, how they are arranged, what are their relationship in the scene. Those are getting more and more important when we take a picture, and we want to also add a certain like augmented effect into the picture. For example, when you use Snapchat, you can add some special effect to the face and also to the surroundings and so on. So the CVP is also designed to do this acceleration for the 3D scene understanding. Here, for the 3D scene understanding, one of the basic function is called SLAM. So SLAM acceleration with a CVP. On the this diagram, the SLAM we have for you can see the input is the camera frames and also the inertial motion sensors, accelerometers, gyroscopes. So the camera frames through feature detector and the tracker. So these tasks are offloaded to the CVP. And then the information, extracted information, will be fused with the inertial motion sensors through this called extended Kalman filter. So this part, we also run it on the DSP instead of CPU for low power consumption. So you can see here is the dedicated hardware and here is the DSP. When them combined together, we really have a low power consumption, since on the mobile platform, the low power consumption is one of the key requirement. So here is another way to put those tasks onto DSP and the CVP. Yeah, so these are like pyramid scalar, feature tracking, three levels of NCC, a key point detection, and another NCC. And then this part run on DSP. So a 3D reconstruction or 3D scene understanding on top of the six, the SLAM or called a 6 degree of freedom algorithm. So here we have not just the SLAM, but also the depth from stereo runs on the CVP. So the input we have, usually we have two sensors from selected from infrared, RGB, or mono camera. So the other part runs on DSP or CPU. So here with this CVP, actually we can extract objects in the scene much faster in real time. So here we can compare the power savings and the compute savings when CVP is used. So without a CVP, when we offload the computation from CPU only to DSP and the GPU, we achieve like a 2x power consumptions. But when CVP is used, the kind of object detection tracking, we can achieve for this task, for body tracking, 6th of, we can achieve 2x power consumption savings. And for our object detection tracking, we can achieve 4x power savings. and also for the computation itself. Computation, because here, because the computation runs on CPU, and compared to with a CVP assistant, it's a 40% of computer savings. And for this object detection and tracking, this is a 96% of computer savings. So that's the first part involved computer vision for mobile imaging. So the second one, actually, I want to introduce my our recent work, actually last year. It's about like a 3D imaging. It's this is a 3D human body reconstruction from a single image and application. So the human body digitalization actually is a very popular topic at CGRAPH or computer vision CVPR conference. So here we have usually we have two approaches to do this. One is called a passive solution. So you can see in the middle, this dedicated setup where multi-view stereo pipeline, and then scan the object, and then we do the interest reconstruction of the 3D shape of this statue or human body. And then this so-called active solution, this is also a dedicated setup to do the 3D scanning. So this is we need a sophisticated 3D scanning device, and you need to go to the studio to do the capture. So those are very tedious and not available for general mobile phone users. So the reconstruction on mobile platform is desired. So on the top, this is also called a multi-view depth fusion approach with a depth sensor camera like the Galaxy S20 Ultra for a phone. You can do the 360 degree scanning, and then through a certain algorithm, the 3D reconstruction of the human body can be done. But then it's not convenient for end users. So here we present a new method to do this kind of single view image. It's an easy setup and it can be done for everyday scenarios. So I just give a brief introduction. So basically capture one picture of a person and then inference the back and also the 3D shape, and then the human body can be modeled in 3D. So our solution is basically two steps: geometry generation and also back texture inference. So here, this is the person to be reconstructed. So we have a input segmentation, and then do a parametric model fitting, and then the front and the back geometry generation, and then we created the reconstructed mesh, and this info gain basically it's a gains type of deep learning inference network, and we create inference the back texture of the person. So with the combination of the front texture and the back texture, and we are able to generate a 3D model of the person. So this is usually called a human digitalization, but with this way, we only need to take one picture, or at most sometimes two pictures. In this way, it can be done by any common smartphone users. Yeah, so it's much easier than the previous approaches. So with this method, actually we published this paper last year, and at CGRAPH, VR CAI conference, and it was one of the best paper there. So in this way, we created a lot of examples and compared our method with some state of the art, and it demonstrates the advantage of this method. And also here on the bottom, we can demo it to create like a virtual short form videos. So these days, like TikTok becomes like very popular for young generation. You can take real videos, but we can generate a virtual video and post there. So this one, you can see the person is with 3D construction, and its action is rendered. And then we put this person like into this hallway. Like a virtual video can be generated. And the next page, I have another. Yeah, this is also. These two, both of them, they are not dancers in the real life, but they are able to create their virtual video through the modeling of the symbolic. So I think this like a 3D modeling of face, head, and also the human body becomes like a very interesting topic called a virtual avatar. So we are also working on the virtual avatar, also work on the other methods, and it becomes like an essential feature for augmented reality. So at Oppo, we also work on augmented reality and the AR glass, and it's basically the mixture of the virtual world and the real world, kind of very interesting. And it's an extension of the traditional digital imaging. Yeah, I think I finished my talk here, and if you have questions, also I'm willing to discuss with you. Thank you, and for listening. Yeah.
Okay, Dr. Messenger, you have questions. I think you can talk directly, actually.
Yeah. So first, I want to thank you both for doing this. I think I got here in 2002, so I think we just kind of crossed paths and missed each other when we were here. First, I just want to make a bit of a statement that, you know, as we're continuing to try to grow the imaging science program, particularly at the undergraduate level, questions about what is imaging science come up all the time. And we talk to young people about their cell phone and the huge amount of science that goes into the fact that, you know, we took a camera that was this big and got it into something that's that tiny and is way more capable in many ways now. And what you guys are doing, I think, only reinforces that message. So really appreciate what you guys are doing and helping to sort of spread the word of what imaging scientists and color scientists do out in the real world. So it's very cool to see what you guys are doing now.
Thank you, Dr. Messenger. Yeah, I lived RIT in 2002, yeah, and my wife Xiaoyun left in 2003, yeah. So, I remember Jeff was the associate director when I was at RIT, yeah, and I had some time crossing with Karen, that's what I knew. Yeah, I think,
You mentioned Harvey Rohde and. His coding class. Harvey retired just a handful of years ago. We still see him once or twice a year.
Oh, really? Nice. He is such a nice person.
and an amazing teacher. With the 3D stuff you were just presenting at the end, you notice that it's amazing how good the virtual avatars are, but there are places where they're kind of still rough around the edges. And what's the limiting factor there? Is it resolution of the camera? Is it the contrast to the background? Is it uncertainty in the mesh model? What sort of drives that uncertainty? What's the big challenge that you need to get over to make those very super smooth looking things?
Yeah, I think the camera is a little bit far from the person, and so the some of the details are like near the ear or mouse cannot be reconstructed correctly. This is like a first generation of a method. We are also improving that, but this mainly illustrates how to generate like the three D model of a person for end users in an easy way. But we are not there yet. Yeah.
Thank you.
Some other question from the audience? Or you can write in the messages in the in the chat channel, and I can read about it.
This is Tony. I have a follow-up question. Along the same line as what Dr. Messenger mentioned, it seems that one of the areas that's noticeable is the feet, and I've seen in 3D reconstruction the problem when the object you're looking at is contacting another object, like in this case, the floor. So are there particular techniques that you've found that help do that better? I understand this is the first iteration, but how did you kind of solve that particular problem?
That's true. We noticed those artifacts. Yeah, I think we are still working on the algorithms to solve the issues. We are not there yet. Yeah. The feet when it's connected to another plane, it's hard to model it. Yeah. So we use a model called the SMPL. So that model it's also needed to be fine tuned for this work.
Thank you.
Actually, I have a question. I have multiple questions. I want to go in order. And for Dr. Jiang, I noticed you talk a lot on the HDR image generation, and you talk about comparison between the DSLR and the mobile phone cameras. For DSLR, and usually people consider that is high quality images, at least in the past. And right now, you mentioned right now the mobile phone cameras actually sometimes is perform better than DSLR. But what I understand is that the difference is mainly because one is totally hardware, another one is supported by some software. From the lens perspective, I think DSLR should be better than the camera. So does it mean right now that really the hardware is the speed of improvement is really getting slower than the software size and for example, than algorithm development, or you think that is something like is direct, both are improving, just right now is improving in different directions?
Because for most of the people, when you look at the images, the color tone noise and the main texture is like the dominant you're feeling. So when you look at the picture in general, you don't zoom in so much, and the appearance can easily for the phone camera to beat the DSLR. Because the main benefit of DSLR is like the big size lens and like the very high quality the the sensor and the lens, the solution wise, the digital image processing part, they should be similar. Right now, the mobile phone camera also have very good solution. And so that's why if for some of the startup, for example, zooming, and because this is the limitation of the mobile phones, so that's why it can always, you have to have several camera. The main reason is to be able to achieve different zoom ratio. And also the texture, the noise texture, fundamental noise texture from the input is still quite different. So that's why DSLR still have this high advantage for the night thing and for when you zoom in to look at all the details. So fundamental, they are still, right now, I think for general users, the gap is getting smaller and smaller. Especially for example, HDR, because the right now with the multiple exposure or different like type of sensor, new HDR sensor, and the mobile phone can achieve better dynamic range comparing to DSLR.
But I think that is still because right now in AI algorithm, people generate HDR images directly from by some deep learning. For example, you generate some HDR image from whatever expensive devices, and then you use AI algorithm to transfer from LDR to HDR. And but from camera DSLR side, that is mainly somehow you have multiple, you change different exposure of the lenses, and then they combine them into one. And that is still somehow software side and hardware side.
Yeah, that's right. In fact, because of the recent both hardware solution and also software power, like the GPU, NSP, the both increase the speed increase quite dramatically. So generation by generation, the increase like double, the computation speed is doubled or something. So many of the things that is very hard to achieve, you know, like machine learning is pretty complicated solution and hard to achieve like a couple of years ago. And now it's like very fast can be achieved even from the mobile device.
Actually, my follow-up question is actually for both you and Dr. Chen. Actually, for my research, I work on HDR and I work on 3D reconstruction both. And the reason is when I somehow try to do some tracking, and when I try to do some image somehow 3D reconstruction using tracking or related task, for example, object recognition, localization, those kind of tasks. In the night, for example, a low illumination, or sometimes in the noon, the strong illumination that is too strong, and I ask my lab student to use LDR to HDR transformation and to generate some reasonable images, and so I can do the tracking, I can do the recognition of those kind of tasks. And obviously, HDR image generation is introduced and conducted by Qualcomm, by Dr. Jiang's lab, Jiang's group, and the 3D reconstruction is significantly done by Dr. Chen's group. Do you guys work together on somehow think about you have collaboration in between to do those kind of things? And I as a faculty in my lab, I do those things freely, but do you work together on those kind of things? I can see a great collaboration in between, yeah, conversation between you guys.
We don't.
We don't. Yeah, not at all. In fact, we don't talk about work at home. So it's like it's, what he does is something new to me, also.
Yeah, yeah. We. I forgot to mention, but actually, I have a small group working on so-called under display camera. So under display camera is a new type of a smartphone design, so that you know, like on iPhone, there's a notch. Sometimes the people doesn't like the notch because it's not a rectangular shape. So we have a new type of design. So hide the camera under the screen, and then the camera information, a signal information from the under the from through the display is awful and. we are using some kind of AI method to reduce like the diffraction, reduce the noise, and reduce the haze and so on. So those are part of the work we actually sometimes also with it's our own solution. It's not on Qualcomm offered for so it's a kind of a competitive. So usually we don't talk to each other unless any of this image processing method. Yeah.
That's interesting. Instead of collaboration, you are competition. There are some competition in between. Actually, you are talking, you are doing what Dr. Jiang is also doing.
Yeah. But Opera is actually one of the largest customer for Qualcomm. So the application engineer level, actually, we work very closely. But then, in terms of the research development, algorithm development, we do some additional features that also Qualcomm work on. So those that part is sort of competitive. Yeah.
Yeah, Oppo is our one of our main customers, so we kind of always need to make them happy. So this is the relationship is very tricky. What we are doing, some difference because my work is mainly focused on the traditional image processing and also the hardware design inside of the camera and also some of the features. But his work is more on learning based and AI based processing. So that's why we don't have much communication.
Yeah. Actually, I mean, back to the other aspect, the imaging science program and also the color science program at RIT are really great. I think both of us get a very feel the program is so good and we benefit from this program. And many of our alumni work on this great companies like Qualcomm. So Xiaoyun is in charge of the imaging algorithms, and we have other alumni in charge for Apple's imaging camera algorithms. Facebook also, and also Google. So we're really proud of the imaging science program, and thank all the faculties to give us the opportunity to work on this amazing field. Yeah,
that's right. You can see RIT graduates in many of the big companies and to take important positions and leading the algorithm development. I think the students, I just want to say, this is really the right measure you selected. So this a lot of potential in industry and you have bright future before you.
Yeah. More than 20 years ago, when I applied to a study overseas, I did have also other choice to other choices, and I think Xiaoyun also, but we elected to come to RIT in the imaging science program. Yeah, I think it's really the right choice in our life, in our career.
That's great to hear. Dr. Messenger, you want to talk?
I just wanted to thank you guys. It definitely, we try to tell our students all the time that, yes, this is a unique program and it's different than any place else, but there is a reason why it is unique and special. And I really appreciate you guys sort of endorsing that and reestablishing that with our students. Particularly, I see online a bunch of our first year graduate students who've only been in Rochester for 6 or 7 weeks and are still very new to this whole thing. So thanks again for that.
Yeah.
Actually, Tony has a question.
I had one more technical question for Dr. Jiang.
Oh, okay.
You spoke about white balance, automatic white balance, And one of the, I think one of the examples you showed was the blue sky, for example, getting the blue sky. Right. So my question is, in the field of remote sensing, we are all often concerned about the illumination. So is it cloud, no clouds, partly cloudy, mostly cloudy? Do your white balance approaches for outdoor scenes, are they concerned about that level of detail, whether it's cloudy or partly cloudy or?
Not that, I don't think it's to that level of the details about a very very accurate color temperature recovery. So sometimes the images is slightly bluish, or the things is not, if it's acceptable, it is acceptable. But in product, in fact, the auto white balance solution or some of the solution is very different from what you think in published the academic paper. So there are a lot of details handling the things in order to make it reliable, there are a lot of special tricks that may not worth to be published, but they're used in the product.
Okay, thank you.
Some other question? So Dr. Quan, actually I have also a technical question for you. And in the 3D, in the single image 3D reconstruction, you showed one image and you showed a video. And is in the video, do you use temporal information to do the reconstruction, or is it something like a video just showing actually one image you do the reconstruction?
Yeah, only one image. So only one image, then we use the SMPL to model the shape of the person, and then use that info gain to influence the back of the person, and then combined, then we generated the 3D shape, and this 3D shape is represented by, say, like by the profile or the key points of the person. So then the motion or dancing is done through the animation through the parts of the body. So all those generated from just one image.
Okay, and does it limit it to the person, or somehow you can, for example, if I just want to reconstruct my hand or my pen, or that can also work, or you set up that must be a person.
We can do mainly a human body, and also the head or face or hand, but not other objects. Yeah.
Yeah, because it's a learning base, right? You need to learn. That's true.
Yeah. Other questions from the audience? If no other question, maybe I just want to ask the final question. Do you have any suggestions to our students, imaging science students, and as the suggestion for their career development? Yeah. As alumni, especially graduating from RIT's imaging science.
Yeah, Xiaoyun, maybe you can talk.
I think that this is definitely the right choice. It's it's a very important area, and we have been in industry about close to 20 years, and we still see the bright future in this area. In fact, even for my son, he's right now a college student. I highly encourage him to learn in this area because of wider usage in the future. So I think definitely this is the right measure to study, and there are different areas. And for me, I think I studied a lot in the color science, but now in fact, it's a little bit, mature in the color science area. So it's more and more areas in typical general image processing. In fact, we are also looking for a new hires in this region. So if you have interest, you can contact me. And also for the AI regions. And so I feel that it's quite a bright future. But I do feel that people right now focus more on machine learning instead of the traditional, like the image processing. This is a little bit, because I feel that in our traditional like image processing, when we need to solve the problems, you have a lot of logics inside it. And for machine learning, and it seems like people are in lack of that strong logical training. So it is hard to like find like a very good, you know, like candidates with each time asking, oh, machine learning here and there. But when they really need to use like the logic to solve the problems, it's like, I still hope that in addition to machine learning, that is very popular for all the students, still have some of the, you know, kind of image processing technology so that when you really need to use like the, your own way, your own logic to solve the problems, that you still have this capability to do that.
Yes, I also echo the same point, because we know that, I mean, seems like a deep learning based method is taking all, but actually in the reality it's not. Still, like the logic centric algorithms like traditional computer vision and also digital image processing, even those like information theory taught by at the imaging science program, are very important to build like a solid foundation for your career. So so don't just jump to the deep learning. Actually, deep learning, to some, actually, it's the easiest thing. We sometimes, like when I was at Qualcomm, we have a high school kids or first grade, like undergraduate. You teach them to do, they can do the deep learning quite relatively easy. But when you ask about some basic image processing or computer vision, those traditional methods, they don't have such training. So I think for our students, yeah, deep learning, you should learn. But don't limit yourself to deep learning. We always, when we interview like a student, we usually ask more fundamental questions to see if they are really have a solid foundation. And also, if you can do some like programming, like C, C++, actually those are also still important for industry when you work on devices. So that is not just for Qualcomm, it's the same for Apple, for Facebook, for Google. Like Facebook, they work on augmented reality, VR, AR. So those are all the wearable hardware devices. They all need to be to run the algorithms efficiently, and those algorithms are not just deep learning based algorithms. So yeah, go deeper. Yeah, that's what I suggest to our students. Yeah,
actually, that is also what currently all the faculties, also Dr. Messenger, always emphasize. Don't just apply deep learning don't just think deep learning is hard. You really need to work on an imaging chain, and every component you should really learn. That is the emphasis of this program, and be benefit from the unique program.
Yes.
Okay. Any other question? If no further question, let's thank to Dr. Chen and Dr. Jiang's excellent talk. Oh, yeah. Oh, so is okay.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you guys very much.
Thank you. It's my pleasure. Yeah.
My pleasure. Yeah.
Yeah. Hope to see you in the future. If you can come to Rochester area, do visit us.
Sure. Yeah.
Thanks a lot.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Messenger. Thanks, Dr. Lu. Yeah.
Thank you.